Hello everyone, in this video we are going to discuss about external features of the cerebrum. Now you know it is situated within the brain box, so when we remove the vault, when we cut it open and then we will remove the meninges, then what we will get is the cerebrum in the form of two cerebral hemispheres. This you can see. This has been put inside the dry skull just to give you an orientation about how it is lying inside and how snugly it is fitted inside. So in the center you will get a longitudinal median fissure, and that divides the entire cerebrum into two equal right and left cerebral hemispheres. Now let me just take it out and we will discuss the external features. So these two are the cerebral hemispheres. Just see from behind and above and from in front, you can separate them. See this, but in the center they are connected with each other. See this from above, and it is just because there are fibers which are crossing the midline and they are connecting the identical areas of one cerebral hemisphere to other cerebral hemisphere. These fibers are termed as commissural fibers, and the largest bundle of commissural fiber is the corpus callosum. So this is what you see is the corpus callosum, which is connecting both the cerebral hemispheres from midline. So this is how it looks like, individual cerebral hemisphere. See this. And unlike spinal cord, what we have got in spinal cord is the outer white matter and inner gray matter. The gray matter of spinal cord looks like alphabet H or butterfly shape. But just opposite to that, the cerebrum is having three layers: outer cerebral cortex, which is made up of gray matter. Then in the center we will get white matter, that is termed as white core of cerebrum. And still embedded within this white core is the gray matter, that is termed as basal nuclei. So by and large, the cerebrum is made up of three structures: outermost cerebral cortex, second layer is the white matter, that is nothing but the axons or the fibers running across the cerebral hemisphere or from higher center to lower center or across the midline. And the innermost gray matter is in the form of basal nuclei. So this is what you see from the surface is cerebral cortex, which is having convolutions, which is having elevations and depressions, and these are termed as sulci and gyri. So what you call fissures and folia in case of cerebellum, let me show you. See, this is the cerebellum. So here also there are elevations and depressions. These are termed as fissures and folia. So depressions are fissures and elevations are folia. Similarly, over here also the depressions are termed as sulci and elevations are termed as gyri. So when you see such type of the cerebral cortex or cerebrum, then it is termed as gyrencephalic type of the brain. That means it is having surface convolutions, irregularities, and particularly in case of human being, there are maximum such gyri and sulci. It is just because to accommodate the large surface area within this brain box. It is said that 2/3 of the surface area of cerebral cortex is hidden within the sulci. See this. And what you see over the surface is just 1/3 of the surface area. On the contrary, for the cerebellum, 85% of the surface area is hidden within the fissures, and what you see on the surface is just 15% of the surface area. So human brain is having gyrencephalic type of the brain, or human is a gyrencephalic. But in case of lower animals, lower mammals, or say for example birds or reptiles, they are having minimum surface area and they don't need such gyri and sulci. So they have got a smooth cerebral cortex and they are termed as lissencephalic. Now you know it is fixed within this cranial cavity and it is divided into anterior, middle and posterior cranial fossa. So accordingly, according to these three cranial fossa, there are three poles: frontal pole, see this, this is the frontal pole, then there is a temporal pole, and then there is an occipital pole. So accordingly, the frontal pole lodges in the anterior cranial fossa. Particularly, if you see it from in front, this is termed as superciliary arch. So exactly just medial over here, supramedial to this superciliary arch over here, just behind to this point, we will get this frontal pole. The temporal pole lodging temporal lobe is found within this middle cranial fossa, and occipital pole is resting over the tentorium cerebelli over here, this portion, and this is the occipital pole. So when you imagine occipital pole found embedded within the cranial cavity, so this is the external occipital protuberance. So just supralateral to this external occipital protuberance, deep inside there will be occipital pole. So this is how three poles of the cerebral hemispheres are accommodated within the cranial cavity. Now when you see it from above, the anterior end is tapered somewhat, and along the posterior half you will get the maximum transverse diameter that is found underneath the parietal tuberosities. So by and large it is oval in shape, it is not circular. This is anterior end and this is posterior end, and when you see the frontal poles, they are more or less rounded as compared to the occipital poles, they are more or less pointed. So this is how from above, from external aspect, you can differentiate which one is the anterior end, which one is the posterior end. And obviously the temporal pole is directed forward, so that too will help you to determine the anterior and posterior pole or anterior and posterior aspect of the cerebrum. So this is median longitudinal fissure, and deep inside, as we have discussed, there is a largest bundle of commissural fiber, that is corpus callosum, holding these two cerebral hemispheres together. And within this fissure it lodges a fold of dura mater, that is fac cerebri. Within the fac cerebri there will be superior and inferior sagittal sinuses. Along with the fold of dura mater, this fissure lodges a fold of arachnoid and pia mater, as well as anterior cerebral vessels are found deep inside. Now when we cut open through this corpus callosum and when we expose it, this is how it looks like. So these two are now cerebral hemispheres separated, and this is what we were discussing. This is the largest bundle of commissural fibers that is termed as corpus callosum. So from in front, from behind, the cerebral hemispheres are separated from each other, but from the center they are connected by this corpus callosum. So this is right and this one is left cerebral hemisphere, and this is how they are connected. So we have cut them open, and deep inside you can see this is the cavity, this is the lateral ventricle, that is the cavity of telencephalon. So what we are seeing right now is nothing but telencephalon, and due to its tremendous growth it assumes large surface area. Say for example, in an adult, on an average the surface area is 2000 square centimeters, and to accommodate this much of surface area, obviously it has to convert into sulci and gyri, and that's why it turns out to be gyrencephalic. So this is the cavity of telencephalon, that is lateral ventricle. Previously we have also discussed cavity of the diencephalon, that is third ventricle. So this is nothing but telencephalon, and it is having, as we have discussed, it is having outermost cerebral cortex, that is gray matter. Then deep inside will be the white core, and still deep inside there will be basal nuclei, that is gray matter. So when we take a coronal section, say this, instead of sagittal section, when we take a coronal section and when we see it from within, just this is how it looks like. Let me zoom in a bit. So this is how it looks like. So outermost is the gray matter, this is in the form of cerebral cortex. Then this is the white matter, you can clearly make out. This is the cavity of lateral ventricle, cavity of the telencephalon. And here you can easily make out the gray matter, okay, that is basal nuclei, that is in the form of caudate nucleus, lentiform nucleus, and certain authorities are also believing subthalamus also functionally as a part of basal nuclei, but by and large you can include caudate nucleus and lentiform nucleus as basal nuclei structurally. So there is a gray matter in the form of cerebral cortex, then there is a white matter in the form of three types of fibers: commissural fibers, association fibers, and projection fibers. And then deep inside, embedded within the white core, there is gray matter in the form of basal nuclei. And deep inside, there is a cavity of the telencephalon, that is lateral ventricle. So this is how structurally the cerebrum or cerebral hemispheres are made. So when we discuss the external features in individual cerebral hemisphere, this is how it looks like. And as we have discussed, there are three poles: frontal, temporal, and occipital. Now you can clearly make out that frontal pole is more or less rounded and occipital pole is more or less pointed. See this. And in between these two, we will get temporal pole. So it is having three poles: frontal, temporal, and occipital. Plus there are borders and surfaces. So there are three surfaces. This one is the supralateral surface, and that is what we see when we open the skull cap. So this is how it looks like. Supralateral surface. See this, when we join these two together, then this is how it looks like, multiple sulci and gyri. And according to the sulci and gyri, we can divide this surface into frontal, parietal, temporal, and occipital lobes, and that we will discuss in a separate video of sulci and gyri. But right now you can imagine this is the supralateral surface, largest surface out of three. And when we cut open, what we see deep inside is the medial surface. So this is medial surface, and you can identify medial surface with the presence of cavity of lateral ventricle and particularly the corpus callosum. Again, there are sulci and gyri, and there are particular lobes like supralateral surfaces, but you can identify it with the presence of corpus callosum. So this is medial surface, this one is supralateral surface, and below is the inferior surface. See this, this is the inferior surface. Let me show you a separate cerebrum without this brainstem and cerebellum, and then you can clearly appreciate the inferior surface. So here, this is the inferior surface. Again, there are sulci and gyri, and there is a presence of a sulcus. This is termed as stem of lateral sulcus. Again, we will discuss it in a separate video, but this is stem of lateral sulcus, and this divides the entire inferior surface into orbital surface and tentorial surface. Okay, so inferior surface is divided into two subcategories: orbital surface and tentorial surface. Now this posterior half of this tentorial surface rests on the tentorium cerebelli. This is the temporal pole, so obviously it rests in the middle cranial fossa, and this portion or frontal surface will rest within the anterior cranial fossa. So this is inferior surface, this is supralateral surface, and deep inside we will get medial surface. So it is having three poles and three surfaces. Now let's see borders. Now there are six borders, and to remember these six borders, you need to remember a pattern like 1, 2, and 3. So number one is supramedial border. This is along the supramedial aspect of each cerebral hemisphere. So for each cerebral hemisphere, this one is the supramedial border. Okay, and let me just separate these two. So here is the supramedial border, and that separates medial surface from supralateral surface. Very easy to remember. This is supramedial border. Next pattern you need to remember is 2. So 1, 2 and 3. 2 is what? 2 is along the infralateral aspect. So along the infralateral aspect, you will get two borders. This one is the superciliary border, and that separates inferior surface or orbital surface from supralateral surface. And this is the infralateral border that separates tentorial surface from supralateral surface. So along the lateral side, this is the superciliary border, and this one is the infralateral border. So one is supramedial border, two are superciliary border and infralateral border, and below you need to remember three, that is along the infromedial aspect there are three borders. This one is the medial orbital border that separates medial surface from orbital surface. Say this. Second one is the hippocampal border. Let me show you a separate cerebrum. See this. So here the brainstem and cerebellum has been removed. So what you can see is this is the medial orbital border separating orbital surface from medial surface. This one, the middle third, is formed by uncus and parahippocampal gyrus, and this is termed as hippocampal border. Obviously it is separating this tentorial surface from medial surface, so this is hippocampal border. And posterior one third, so basically we can divide into anterior, middle and posterior third. So posterior third, say this one, it is medial occipital border, and that separates this remaining tentorial surface from the medial surface. So three borders along the infromedial aspect: medial orbital, hippocampal and medial occipital. Two along the infralateral aspect: superciliary and infralateral border. And one along the supramedial aspect, that is supramedial border. So this is how there are six borders. You can remember by 1, 2 and 3 pattern. There are three surfaces: supralateral, medial and inferior. Inferior is subdivided into orbital and tentorial. And there are three poles: frontal, temporal and occipital. So this is how the external features of cerebrum are there. For sulci and gyri, we will discuss it in a separate video. So this is regarding today's topic. Hope you understood well. Thanks for watching.